I was growing up in the town of Tannersville, Appenzell, up in the Poconos. Anybody know Appenzell? Tannersville area? Okay, it's a Catholic church. Used to be there, called Our Lady of Victory Catholic Church. It's where I grew up. I grew up in that Catholic church. And on Palm Sunday, it'd be one of my favorite times of the year. You probably know why. It's because you come home with something from church that day, which was cool. You're always, you know, sitting there listening and then just going home, but you had to come home with something. And when, you know, I tried to steal as much palm as possible from the pews, and we would take that all home. And here's the thing that I remember the most. I remember sitting at the table once we got home from church. We sit down with Grandma, and Grandma would start showing us how to fashion crown of thorns and palm crosses, which some of you have, yes, I hope. You have some palm crosses with you? Good. Ah, they're going to come in handy today. Maybe through the rest of the week, too. But I remember and I adore that time. I cherish that time. It was just such a positive memory of what Palm Sunday was all about and what my faith upbringing was all about. Now, I'm a Methodist now. My parents, they're probably watching the live stream, so I'll probably get a phone call after this, but I'll say this. They still think I'm going to be a Catholic priest at some point. Shh. I don't know if that'll happen, but but I can tell you, being raised Catholic and having some of that ritual and some of the things that we talk about, like on these high holy days, in Holy Week, and of course coming up to Easter, which is the highest holy day, we can celebrate. I just remember and having that upbringing, and I hope that's the same for you or you recall those today. However, we need to make something very clear within ourselves on Palm Sunday, because it's not just Palm Sunday. You know that, right? It's Palm Passion Sunday. And the preponderance of churches are not going to celebrate Palm Passion Sunday because they just want to do the palms. It's going to be a happy time. Let's just do palms and I'll go home. And then, I don't know when we'll see you next, but, you know, Easter's coming, and of course everybody's going to show up for Easter, but therein lies the problem. You can't go from the lesser joy of Palm Sunday to the greater joy of Easter without going through what? The Passion of Christ. We can't go from here to there and lightly skim over the fact that our Savior died for us and all that surrounds that. So Pastor Nancy and I are going to tell the story in 30 seconds. We're going to go through the story in bits and pieces. There are 8 smaller candles on the altar. You'll hear 8 readings. You can probably tell what that center candle might stand for. That would be the Christ candle. And at the appropriate time, we will also douse the Christ candle. It's a backwards candle lighting is what it is. For us to understand that not only do we experience joy this morning, but as we move through Holy Week, as we go from worship today, then worship on Thursday, and worship on Friday, and worship, a quiet worship, different kind of worship on Saturday, and then celebrate Sunday, we'll understand the greater story of what Christ has done for us. Let's not skip over that piece. Catholics taught me that too, by the way. Catholicism did. That the suffering of Christ is key to understanding who Christ is. Let's take that opportunity today. Pastor Nancy and I will now begin to share that story. In between each of those readings, we're going to have you sing a verse of a hymn. You just go ahead and sing it as you see it put up on the screen, and then we'll continue our time together walking down the path of scriptures that are laid out for us in Mark.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping and said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked.
What wondrous love is this? Oh, my soul, what wondrous love is this? Oh, my soul, what wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse?
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.'" But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But he was silent, and he did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" And all of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him.
While Peter was in the courtyard below, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And he broke down and wept.
Who was the guilty?
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered them, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you?" But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Lo, the good shepherd, for the sheep is offered. The slave hath sinned, and the son hath suffered for our atonement.
You can't go from the lesser joy of Palm Sunday to the greater joy of Easter without having to acknowledge the passion or suffering of Christ. Now, if I asked you why Jesus had to endure such suffering, I hope you would have an answer for me. You probably know what it is. You probably would tell me that he had to suffer and die for what? For our sins, right. Your Sunday school teachers would be very impressed. Which reminds me of why we need Jesus in the first place. Because of sin, yours and mine, and everyone's ever in the world, past or future, you and I are sinners. And that's something we have to own today. And just to be clear, while God loves us, God hates sin. And because God is a just God, there is a penalty, or there must be a penalty, for being absolved of sin. Somebody has to pay. There are consequences of sin. There is a cost associated with Jesus taking those consequences away from us. The penalty Jesus took on our behalf was nothing less than torture and suffering in a most horrific way, to the very edge of his life, and then death, separated from his Father. But you know that already. So perhaps, as you hear the story again, maybe for the first time, maybe you would appreciate the suffering of Christ in a deeper way. Because here's the reason why. It's a little too disconnected for us to simply admit that we are sinners. We all know that. We would, yes, I'm a sinner. But where does that intersect life for us? What does that really mean for us on a day-to-day basis? You see, our lives are much more fragile than just being able to say, well, I'm a sinner and Jesus loves me. And there's more depth. There's more love. There's more mercy. There's more everything behind that. The palm cross in your hands represents spiritual fragility. That is, that's our human tendency to speak up for Christ when it's safe or it benefits us to do so, and our tendency to clam up at the very least and outright deny him when the situation calls for that. Every time we do this, we do something nobody wants to admit. Anybody want to take a gander about what that would be? Every time we do that, we crucify Jesus again. Every time. It's easy to shout Hosanna when everything's fine, but when our faith is challenged, we lose our voice and we lose our nerve. And sometimes we switch sides. Where were the shouts to save Jesus when he was delivered to Pilate, like when he was coming into town just 5 days earlier? Where were the Hosannas then? I think Jesus might have appreciated them a little more at that point. In one moment, the people shouted Hosanna, not 5 days later would yell what? Right. And it's supposed to be awkward, and you know, if you're going to mean it, for you to say crucify him, because that's exact, I'm trying to make the point that that's exactly what we do. We crucify him again. We put the Savior on the cross again. This is the way we treat our Savior today. We praise him in church and around church friends and family, but we remain comfortably quiet when Jesus' name is made fun of at work or used as the butt of jokes or his name used irreverently or maybe just even ignored the rest of the week. Our world is full of instances where God is completely absent, if not mocked. We must see to it that our faith does not become fickle, that is, unreliable, inconsistent, according to convenience. Will we shout Hosanna when the path is clear and life is going well, and then turn around and blame God when things take a turn for the worse, or there's seemingly nothing to be gained by having faith? Will our faith turn into sarcasm or apathy? Will we drop church attendance or ditch the live stream and other disciplines of the faith and wait until we feel like there's a good reason to re-engage? Will we continue to make dumb Facebook posts that hurt other people? Will what was once a shout of faith become a shout of disbelief in varying degrees depending on our situation? I know what you're going to answer. No, I would never do that. Really? If you honestly assessed where you were as a sinning saint, would you answer that in a positive way? That's why you have a palm cross in your hands today. It represents the fickleness, the dramatic irony of our faith, the joy of palm, and the horror of our Savior being put on an instrument of torture. There it is in your hands. You can't get to an empty grave with just palm. You need to have a cross, too. The good news today is that no matter how fickle our faith, and I said this earlier too, I don't know why I feel compelled to say this. I preach out of my own experience and my own context. I'm just as fickle as anybody else. But no matter, Jesus died for us. That's the good news. And I think we know that too. Whether we have a palm in our hands or hammer and nails in the other, Jesus still dies. And this is very important. Jesus loves unconditionally all of the time, no matter whether you have a palm or a hammer and nails. You have both anyway. Let's face it. Interestingly enough, while they, those who were crucifying Jesus, were driving the spikes, he was asking his Father to do what? Like he forgives us. For they and we do not know what we are doing. While we did not understand him, he understands us, and he forgave us. Palm in our palms or hammer in our hands, he forgave us. He meets our fickle faith by loving us. And while we are faced with the suffering and death of Christ in his passion that we recall today, we hold out hope because he loved us. And do you know how much he loved us? And I'm not going to put my hands out, but I am going to say he loved us to death. Palm, passion, resurrection. Jesus loves us. Thanks be to God. Jesus loves us.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. After they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews," they struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you would have destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days. Save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let's see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last.
Evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. I'm going to ask you to pause at this time for a moment of silence and just reflect on what you have heard through scripture, sermon, and music. And then I would like to share a prayer written by John Killinger. Cheerleaders, they were hard at work when Jesus entered Jerusalem, weren't they, O God? Everybody was happy. They had a Messiah. God was favoring them. Everything was going their way. So they called out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It was a natural thing to do. We're the same, Lord. We too find it easy to cheer when things are going well. It's on the dark days when it's harder, the days when nothing seems to go right, when life seems dull and heavy, days when we're sick or lose our jobs or fail a test or have a quarrel we didn't want to have. Then we don't remember to cheer very much. It's a lot harder to be cheerful in days when we're feeling crucified, when all the fun has gone out of life and we're alone with our problems. Revive our spirits this week, O God. Remind us of your faithfulness, even on the dark days, even when we feel abandoned. Help us to be steady in all kinds of days, to wait on you in the hardest of times, to know you are there and that you care and that joy returns with the morning. Forgive our times of doubt and our failures of nerve. Renew our faith and teach us to believe at all times, whether everybody's cheering or everybody has forsaken us. Let us move on faithfully with Christ, caring more for truth and honor and love and devotion than we do for applause and accolades. And grant that this church may always be a place of refuge and encouragement for everyone who comes here and for all our members whose hands and hearts are joined even when they are apart. Touch us with healing and with hope. Let peace, your peace, attend us all the days of our lives through the Christ of triumph and of pain. Amen.
Kristen, I'm going to ask you a favor. I want you to put down all the lights you possibly can in the sanctuary. Just douse every single one of them, please. If it were completely dark in here, no light outside, no light in the back, no glow of technical gear, do you know how piercing that one light would be? I think you would be astounded. One light can light up an entire room if we let it. Before you leave today, you see the other 8 candles are out because we just told the story of the suffering of Christ and his death. Jesus died. It wasn't faked. It wasn't something other than that. Jesus died. And yet, because of people, we are people of faith, we believe that that one light brings hope. That is what we have to hang on to for a week. That's what we have to hang on to when we move from worship and continue our worship into Holy Thursday or Maundy Thursday, and we continue our worship into Good Friday, and we continue our worship into a quiet Saturday that reflects on the whole thing, the whole story. Because when we get back on Sunday, that light will be that much brighter. Let's not skip over the tough parts of our faith, and that is to truly embrace and to own the fact that Jesus suffered and died. And he suffered and died because if he didn't, we could not be gods. All right, watch your eyes as we turn back on the lights. Okay, that hurt. Pastor Nancy and I want to invite you to come back. Don't isolate this service. Holy Week, especially Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. That's called the Great 3 Days, or the Great Triduum. Okay? Those 3 days belong together. Today starts
our worship as we go into those days. We can say Hosanna because we know the truth, but let us be real with ourselves as we travel through this week and we prepare ourselves for the ultimate reality we know as the resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ. So go forward today, be blessed, but stay in a worship mode, because I think what will happen is we will find out if we will travel this road and even the dark parts of this road together, we will find great joy in what happens a week from today. Thank you for coming. I hope to see you Thursday either here or on the live stream. And by all means, bring somebody with you or into your home, whatever you need to do. I guess just wear a mask. How's that? Okay. Anyway, be blessed, brothers and sisters. We will see you very, very soon.